morning, Mr. Stanton.
General Thomas.
Good morning, gentlemen. I have no wish to disturb these gentlemen. I can wait.
There's nothing private here, sir. What can I do for you?
I am Secretary of War ad interim, and I'm ordered by the President of the United States to take charge of this office.
General Thomas, I am Secretary of War, and I order you to repair to your rooms and to exercise your functions as Adjutant General of the Army.
I shall obey the orders of the President, who has ordered me to take charge of the War Office.
And how, may I ask, do you plan to take possession? Do you mean to use force?
I do not care to use force, but I shall stay here and act as Secretary of War.
I am Secretary of War, and your superior. Have a drink.
My pleasure, sir.
This was a test case of the rights and power of the presidency against the rights and power of Congress. President Andrew Johnson was attempting to replace his own Secretary of War, Edwin Stanton. Congress had passed a law which forbade it without the Senate's consent. Johnson held that the law was unconstitutional. He wanted it brought to a test. It was, but not in the form he'd expected. And it would have ended in disaster if it were not for a United States Senator whose name none recalls, Edmund G. Ross. Johnson was the United States Senate, and the warriors were some of the most powerful men in the Reconstruction period. Against Johnson, Benjamin Butler, Charles Sumner, Thaddeus Stevens, and Samuel Pomeroy. Among those four, Johnson, John Henderson, and Lyman Trumbull. But the trial would be decided by one man who was still undecided, Senator Edmund Ross.
Silence while the House of Representatives is exhibiting to the Senate of the United States the articles of impeachment against Andrew Johnson, President of the United States.
Article 1. That said Andrew Johnson did.
There were 11 articles of impeachment against President Johnson. He was charged with illegally removing Stanton from office and with abusing Congress. But the real issue was a hidden one. Could the Congress dominate the president? The independent power of Andrew Johnson as President of the United States was being challenged by the Republican majority in Congress. Johnson's trial got underway on March 5th, 1868, and it began with every prospect of a conviction.
Patterson of New Hampshire.
Certain.
Pomeroy is certain. Ramsey.
Certain.
Ross of Kansas, certain. Sherman.
Oh, wait a moment. Ross.
Mm-hmm.
Has any of us actually talked to Senator Ross?
I wouldn't see the need of it.
Pomeroy.
Ross, why, I scarcely know the man. He's from Kansas. He's Republican. He votes very regular. I don't see why we're...
Sam, your junior colleague, Ross, you consider him sound on impeachment?
As a rock. Why?
Well,
None of us knows him to speak of, and I heard him make a remark the other day, something to the effect of this being a trial and wanting to maintain a completely impartial judgment.
Oh, Ed Ross is a high-principled sort of fellow, but I see no reason...
Is Ross a lawyer?
No, he prints a small newspaper. As I say, he sometimes takes himself rather seriously, but I'd be startled.
Pomeroy, we can't afford any startles. We need 36 votes to convict Johnson. If all the Republicans hold the line, we have them. When we start taking votes for granted and they start slipping away from us...
Gentlemen, Edmund Ross fought to make Kansas free soil. He fought Jayhawkers and Indians. Fought all through the Civil War. When men like Andrew Johnson and Jim Lane started temporizing with the South, it was Ed Ross that raised the mass meetings in Kansas, got up and put through the resolutions that condemned it. Now you ask me if Ed Ross is certain. Yes, I think you might call him that.
Ross.
Very soon after, I received a note from Colonel Moore, the private secretary of the president, that the president wished to see me. I immediately went to the White House and saw the president.
And what was said by the president at that time to you or by you to the president?
I reported to the president that I might demand the office, but I thought that Mr. Stanton would not yield.
And what did the president say?
The president said, very well, we want it in the courts. I then went over to the War Office to Mr. Stanton's room. I stated that I came from the president to demand the office. I made the demand a second and a third time. He has often refused and ordered me to my room.
Have you ever, at any time, attempted to use any force to get into that office?
At no time.
Have you ever had any instructions or directions from the president to use force, intimidations, or threats at any time?
As I said,
Wait.
At any time? Well, that would bring it down to today. Well, I suppose the ruling did not come down today. Now, at any time prior to the 21st or the 22nd of February, I'm content with your inquiring about it. But I must object to putting in anything that was said yesterday.
On the 9th of March, you say it's to continue.
9th of March?
Then we shall inquire prior to the 9th of March.
Well, I didn't say anything about that. To me, the 9th of March is just as bad as if it would be today.
We have a right to negative up to the point at which you gave...
The heat, I think.
I'll get a carriage for you.
No, I'll just rest a moment. It passes off. What do you think of that in there?
Well, it's quite an occasion.
I mean, what's your opinion so far?
Well, I'm a Republican, sir, like yourself. I'm willing to think the president's a fool, but I can't say it's clear to me yet he's a villain. I mean to say... Every small point that's come up, the president may claim he's only defending his rights according to his view of the Constitution. Now, I may privately doubt that, but I had hoped for some clear proof against him.
What if it never comes? What if you, as a good Republican, have to vote on no better evidence than you've heard so far?
I'd be in some difficulty. Huh. Putting aside to President Johnson himself, I ask myself... what this trial may do to our system of government.
Yes. Russ, I'd say this. Andrew Johnson is unimportant. The sound and fury of right now is unimportant. What is important going on in there is a contest for power between Congress and the presidency. In this case, the power will go to the side that can get it. And we'll decide that. Have you spoken to any of the others about this?
Well, I tried. I don't believe they're much concerned. They get a look in their eyes as if I were talking Persian. Well, sir...
Well, Senator, I have a question for you. You said before you're feeling some difficulty of mind. I know some others. Good Republicans. Fessenden. Trumbull. Henderson. And maybe one or two others. Ross, what if this thing becomes close?
Oh, I scarcely see how it can.
How it can? Let's do some arithmetic. 54 senators. 36 can carry it. Conviction needs a two-thirds vote. 19 can defeat it. How to get 19? Let's start with 12 Democrats. Then start counting Republicans crossing over. Fessenden, 30. Trumbull, 40. Possibly Henderson, 50. Fowler, that's conceivable, 60. Even Van Winkle, 70.
I still don't see it coming to that.
What if it does? That's a question I've been asking myself. What if it comes to me?
Charming landlady. Am I behind on the rent?
There's another Kansas delegation down below.
You're requesting me politely to disembowel the president?
You could skin down the back stairs.
No, they elected me.
That's what they're telling each other. Mayor?
On the table, please.
Has anyone said a kind word about the president?
No one's accused him of bigamy. Remarkable, the trial's not over, and I'm the only remaining citizen of Kansas who hasn't decided.
I spoke to Perry yesterday. He said Senators Fessenden, Trumbull, and Henderson are likely to stand against conviction.
Like standing against a rock slide.
But if they could persuade three or four others, Perry says the betting's closer to even. Well, up until yesterday, he was thinking of putting money on the president.
Well, what happened yesterday?
Senator Grimes.
Well, Senator Grimes, he's one of the few you mentioned, along with Fessenden, Trumbull.
Haven't you heard about him? Did anybody tell you?
What, Vinny?
Senator Grimes had a stroke yesterday. Haven't you heard?
No, I hadn't heard about that.
They say he's dying.
Senators, I demand, in the name of the House of Representatives and the people of the United States, judgment against the accused for the high crimes and misdemeanors in office whereof he stands impeached, and of which, before God and man, he is guilty.
Order! Order! Sergeant-at-Arms, clear the gallery.
Final arguments in the trial of President Andrew Johnson were begun on April 22nd. Senate voting on his guilt or innocence was scheduled to begin 5 weeks later. The prosecution was optimistic. The president's defense counsel was not.
But if, senators, as I cannot believe, but has been so boldly said, your votes have been canvassed and the doom of the president is sealed, then let that judgment not be pronounced here in this Senate chamber, not here where he fought the good fight for the Union and the Constitution. No, not here.
Senator Henderson, Senator Trumbull.
Senator, it's extremely reckless of you to come near us. You're consorting with lepers.
I heard your reasoning against conviction on Tuesday, sir.
You listened?
You mentioned the statutes of 1863, 1792, and 17... What was it?
1795, State Treasury and War. You're being very conscientious about this.
Well, I take it seriously.
So do we, Senator, for a fact. Are you serious about this, Ross? I never thought of you. I mean, it never occurred to me, you being from Kansas.
Excuse me, sirs. May I talk with my colleague?
Talk away, Pomeroy.
Edmund, you shouldn't mix about with them. Not at this point.
Well, I wanted some information. Trumbull's a lawyer.
We have lawyers on our side. Those two have turned their back on the party. That's death, and they know it.
Then they must have reasons, huh?
I'm making a count of our things. Wanted you to sign on.
What is that?
Articles of impeachment. Senators for and against conviction on each count. Everyone signed. It's a matter of convenience. We want to find out and bring up the decisive articles first. Which do you support?
Well, I suppose that... Oh, no. No, sir.
Senator, you startled me.
You startled me? Sam, you'll get your conviction sure enough. What does it matter how...
How do you stand?
I'm not decided yet on all points.
Well, they're decided at home in Kansas. This came for you and me jointly.
Kansas has heard the evidence and demands the conviction of the president. D.R. Anthony and 1,000 others. I don't recognize they have that right.
We represent them here.
They have no right to demand I vote either for or against conviction. My only duty in this matter is to give them an explanation. I have taken an oath to do impartial justice according to the Constitution and laws, and trust that I shall have the courage to vote according to the dictates of my judgment. Signed, E.G. Ross, U.S. Senate.
Edmund, I'm not asking for a final commitment. Just tell me your intentions.
Not to be written down?
For myself, my own guidance.
Well, I'm inclined to support the first article. That contains everything between the president and Stanton. The next eight just seem to repeat it.
Then you'd support them, too.
What if I do the first?
What about the 11th article? That's the most general.
Sam, why are you prodding me? What do I matter either way? You've got enough votes for conviction. It looks certain to me.
Yes, and when it's certain, it's not a time for you to hang back. When a thing is going to carry, the thing that people feel strongly about, powerful men, perhaps the most powerful in all this country, men who could do you all kinds of good or harm.
I only want to make up my own mind.
You have everything you might need for a fine career. Good appearance, a fine war record, good skill with words.
What has my career got to do?
There are times not to antagonize people, not to be strict and stubborn. Times to go along with.
I have no wish to antagonize anyone. I have a great wish to decide things for myself. I haven't yet.
You needn't be harsh with me. I know your intentions.
I haven't decided yet.
Senator, did you really mean that?
Sir?
I mean that like Trumbull and myself and a few other lonely villains, you might take a stand against the great moral majority.
All I'm trying to say, sir, all I mean, I'm not decided.
Pomeroy, you told us once to mark him down as certain. Certain as Henderson, certain as Trumbull. I hope you all feel it. This thing is slipping away from us.
Perhaps if you'd go to him yourselves. He's not a well-known man, even at home. If you could make him feel important to you, valuable, you understand.
There's a bushel of money. How much does the scoundrel want?
That was not my meaning, sir.
Has it occurred to you, gentlemen, that Senator Ross might be that rarest of all rare things, a genuinely thoughtful man?
Yes. Senator Sumner, I think Representative Stevens is right. You should go to him on the basis of reason.
Well, he has to be gone to somehow.
Yes?
Edmund?
Perry, come on in. What are you doing about town? I didn't hear you come in the house.
I didn't use the streetway.
Oh, what is it?
I brought you a small gift. Oh, it's not conspicuous.
It's our riverboat gamblers, preachers, and statesmen's model. You can slip it in your pocket.
Why?
Oh, there's an excitement in the city. You have your name in the papers. I hear it on the streets. You're becoming famous, Edmund. But not popular.
But I don't see the need for that.
Well, you know me, Senator. I hear all the rumors in town. Shall I tell you one? In the next day or so, you'll be invited on a pleasure trip with friends. And on this trip, you'll be offered the opportunity to pledge yourself against Johnson.
If I won't pledge?
If you won't, they say you'll be kept away until the voting is over.
And how would they keep me away?
It's a rumor. I don't vouch for it.
I'm glad you don't. I'd call you daft.
Shall I tell you a second rumor? They say you've been bribed already. That a man on Johnson's side has got to you.
What man?
Myself.
Harry.
They say you've been offered Indian contracts through my bureau. I'll have to avoid your company the next few weeks, Edmund. It'll be better for both of us if we're not seen together.
I'd better take you outside and put your head under the pump. Perry, I can imagine rumors. I know I'm not well liked, but to believe someone's idle talk.
I'll show you something that's more than rumor. Turn the lamp down, Edmund. I came in the back way. He's not just loitering there. It's not that kind of street or time of night. You're being followed and watched, Edmund.
Why?
Well, there are thousands of men in Washington who have something to gain or lose. Gain position, cabinet posts, ambassadorships, lose money. $1 million is riding on Johnson's conviction in bets alone. You think a man wouldn't kidnap for that? Or kill? I want you to carry this.
But it doesn't depend on me. The conviction? It doesn't.
Edmund, Fowler has already gone over to acquittal. And there's news from Grimes. He says he's going to attend the session next Saturday.
He can't. He's a sick man.
He says he'll vote to acquit Johnson if he dies doing it. That brings it to 6 Republicans crossed over, brings it to you. Edmund, you're the only man in the Senate who hasn't declared himself. And how you vote, that's how it will go. It couldn't depend on you more if you were Almighty God.
Joining me for a cup of tea. I only have a few minutes. I'm going back to Baltimore. All right.
Say, you've been under a bit of pressure these last few days. I can imagine.
Yes, I find I'm actually being kept under watch.
You're sure of that?
Well, I know it doesn't sound likely.
But I can say you look pretty fit, considering. Your wife and children well?
According to their letters.
Off there in Kansas. They should be with you.
Can't afford it.
Shame. I was talking to a man yesterday with a good deal at stake. He said he'd spent $100,000 to determine this trial.
For which side?
Oh, this man is... Senator, what is it?
Nothing.
You thought I would come to you with a proposition? Are things that desperate?
They're, confused.
I wish there were something I could do, Ed. You're very tense. I'll tell you. Come to Baltimore with me overnight. You'll be out of the city, away from this uproar. Have a night's sleep. You can take the train back tomorrow morning. Come to the station with me now. There's just time. No need to worry about packing. I can outfit you in good shape. We'll be there in 2 hours. I'll give you a good meal. You can have a night's rest, and you... You've heard something. No harm would have come to you, Ed. I was promised that. I'm your friend. You mustn't think badly of me, Ed. I'm beholden to certain people.
Stan wanted to counsel with you, Ross. You've given us some anxiety.
Not by choice.
We vote Saturday, and we know everyone's mind but yours.
You look distressed, Senator. Do I have my wig on backwards? I feel a grudging respect for you, Senator. You're under some pressure, I hear. Even some torment.
Yes.
But you've gone straight along your own way. Now, Ross, I only want to understand your way. What is it that keeps you separate?
Well, I'm not yet sure on the charges made, on the evidence produced.
Ross, suppose we agreed with you.
What?
I suppose we concede that the proof against Johnson wasn't as tight as we'd like it. Suppose we have to proceed on charges not made and evidence not heard.
Sir, how can a trial proceed on that?
Exactly. Exactly. And this is not a trial.
But everyone speaks of it as
this
being...
This is not a trial, Ross, and we are not judges. We don't pronounce sentences, we only vote. Impeachment is not a punishment. It's simply a removal from office. We are a Senate, a political body. Impeachment is a political action taken in the national interest.
No one's proposed this to me before.
Does the Constitution call it a trial? No, the Constitution says Congress makes the laws, the President carries them out. The President is the executive, the manager, so to speak. If he manages the laws carelessly, poorly, or ignores them willfully, the Constitution says simply, we may vote the rascal out.
But for cause, sir, high crime or misdemeanor?
For what misdemeanor do we need? More than that he's abusive, obstructive, grasping, and incompetent. What evidence more than the whole world knows it? I think you do. Not a trial, Ross. Not a trial.
Ross... I've served in the Congress a great many years. And I've seen a thing happening these last 10. Oh, happening very slowly, so as a man it's hard to notice, but I've seen authority leak in and dribbling away. From where? From Congress. To where? To the President. Now, and like Lincoln during the war, one was inclined to let it happen. Trust the man. But Andy Johnson... defending the Constitution, he says. He's defending 10 years of expediency and stolen power. I've seen the presidency swell up to something like a dictatorship. And I say the time has come to puncture it.
Sir, why wasn't the case put squarely on that basis?
I wish it had been.
Find any basis you want. It's a clear enough case for a Kansas man. I wouldn't think a Kansas man could quibble with his country.
Yes, I'm from Kansas, but...
We have to vote this thing through.
Why? When you give me reasons, as you were doing, I'm grateful, I'm impressed. But when you say to me, you must vote for this for your political sake, or because you're from Kansas, or I must vote for this simply because I must vote for this, well then, yes, sir, I start to quibble.
Charles. Ross, let me ask you quite simply. We've given you our reasons. Are you impressed by them?
Yes, a good deal. I want to think about them.
You'll settle this thing, you know that. You alone in all this world. You have it in the cup of your hand.
Yes, sir. I know that.
Major.
General Sickles, I can say I'm surprised.
You looked surprised.
General Sickles, if Secretary Stanton sent you to harangue me, sir, I've spent all day.
No.
I go to vote in a few hours.
Just thought we might have a little chat.
I'll make some tea.
I went today and visited my leg.
The what?
My leg, sir. I gave it to the War Museum.
Oh, yes, I heard. I'm sure they're most grateful.
Yes, I went down there and looked at it. It's embalmed. Must say, it was drawing a fair crowd. It's damn peculiar to think it was hitched to me once.
Yes, sir.
But I always say it's good to preserve things. People forget. They forget the war.
Yes, they do.
Not you and I, Major. Soldiers, we try not to forget, huh? You've been chivvied about a good deal the last few days.
Yes, General, I have. I've been in some fear for my life.
Hmm?
I've been followed in the streets. People watch this house at night.
Scum!
General, I wouldn't show myself.
What are you doing out there? What do you want? Shoot a soldier, would you?
Seems quiet enough now. Remember nights like this, Major? Times we tented on the banks of rivers? Soft, warm nights.
Yes.
Sounds like artillery, huh? Puts me in mind. I walked out one night before Chancellorsville. I remember a lad on picket duty. Stopped and talked with him. At a stone fence, I remember. He was a youngster, about 16, I judge. With a pleasant, roundish sort of face. We stood just as far as I am from you, sir. Do you know death came and sat between us? Did you ever have that experience, Major? Of being with a man and knowing that...
Yes.
I sat with him and he said, "General, I confess I'm in great fear." And I answered him some commonplace about that being the lot of a soldier. And then he said to me, "I find it hard to trust." "Oh, I trust you, sir. You're a good man." "No," I said. "We must trust in God and the rightness of our cause. Men should be free in dignity. Every man created by God should have his fair chance of fortune. I believe that. I trust that. Do you, soldier?" I said. And he said, "Yes, General. I can trust that." Next morning, we attacked. caught us in enfilade. Grape and canister. They mowed us, sir, like wheat. And afterwards, I wandered over the battlefield. I found him lying on his back, that boy. That child of someone's love. Cartridge between his teeth and his fair face torn open. Oh, we give orders, men like you and me.
Ross, why do you hesitate now? Why? The cause is just. Thank God no one need die for it.
I have a complication of mind, General. I have no care for Andrew Johnson. But I have some care for the presidency. Do you understand that, sir?
I'm willing to, Ross.
General, we have put the president on trial. A very long trial. I've been over it and over and heard the most skillful reasoning. But I'm simply not sure on the counts charged, on the evidence given. As carefully
Ross,
as I can...
I could give evidence. I was put in command of the Carolinas. The war had been fought. I saw the South ready to accept its results in good faith. And I saw Johnson muddle and retreat and double deal as if there'd been no war, no results. Respecting the Negro, he told the South, make your own laws. The result, the black code, sir, in my own department. No Negro or mulatto shall hold employment except as farmer or servant. No Negro shall sell farm produce without written permit. Negro shall be liable for capital punishment for stealing a horse or a mule or baled cotton. Freedom, the dignity of man, I abolish the black codes. But Johnson suspended me for abolishing these despicable codes. A conceited cuckold, he called me. An abomination in the sight of God. You believe me?
Yes.
Well, then.
Sir, the president is on trial. I must vote according to the charges made and the evidence heard in that trial. Only that.
Ignoring these other things.
Yes, sir.
Well, then say it isn't a trial. Say it's a political action in the national interest. That's Sumner's argument. Take it on those grounds. Take the wide view.
Sir, that leads to another thing. If you say to me, this is a political action, or if you say to me, take the wide view, I must take the widest and longest political view I can. Is that reasonable?
Yes.
I must take what we're doing now and try to reckon the results of it in every future time. I must ask, if we remove the president, if we set this example of Congress's power, what will it do to our system of government? A makeshift system, Mr. Stevens calls it. Well, I'd have to agree, it's changed through the years. But it somehow seems to me that the power of Congress is in rough balance with the power of the presidency. And for all the friction and clattering the system's borne us along through wars and panics, perhaps it'll carry us for a long time yet.
Ross, Major, before God, sir, the thing is now. You talk about future times. What about Andrew Johnson? What about the wreckage he made of everything we fought for?
Sir, these things are grievous to me.
Come to the window with me. Come over here, man. No one will hurt you. Look out there at the dead. 500,000 dead. Their bones lying out there in gullies and graves and hedges tangled with vines. Look at them. They had faith enough to die. Your men, your companions. You drank from the same cup with them. You shared their blankets in the cold. Who'll keep them from the cold now? Who keeps their faith? Major, can you stand against this army of dead? Can you say to them, I choose to betray you? Major Ross, can you scorn and forget?
I'm a senator. General, you must call me Senator.
Commanded to keep silence while the Senate of the United States
is sitting for the trial of the Articles of...
Where's Grimes? Has the ambulance come yet? Where's Ross?
Ross left his rooming house before daybreak. Went walking somewhere in the streets.
The secretary will now read the journal of last Tuesday's proceedings of the Senate sitting for the trial of the impeachment.
Journal of impeachment trial proceedings for Tuesday, May 12, 1868. The Chief Justice of the United States took the chair. The usual proclamation was made by the Sergeant at Arms. Messrs. Managers Bingham, Boutwell, Logan, and Stevens appeared at the manager's table. Messrs. Stanberry, Everts, and Grosbeck of counsel for the...
See if you can get any word of Grimes and Ross.
The secretary proceeded to read the journal of yesterday's proceedings of the Senate, sitting for the trial of the impeachment. Mr. Edmund, as time is rapidly flying, I move that the further reading of the journal be dispensed with. The Chief Justice, it will be so ordered if there is no objection. Mr. Davis, I object. I want the journal read. Secretary resumed and concluded the reading of the journal. Mr. Edmunds, I move to take up the order that I offered yesterday. The Chief Justice...
Senator, you have left us with some anxiety.
Oh, I've been walking around looking at this extraordinary city. Has it begun yet?
Oh, we have a moment or two. They considered whether to present the 11th article first. I believe you wanted it so. We've tried to arrange all matters to your convenience, sir, except for postponement. We can't give you that. We feel that now is the time to front the issue.
I'm not sure there's much point in our talking.
Then I'll talk, sir. I'll ask a question. You were seen this early morning going to Mr. Perry Fuller's house. For what purpose was that?
I took breakfast there and I shaved. And he lent me a coat. Mine was wet from the rain.
Senator Ross, I'm told to inform you that we expect your vote for conviction. If you withhold it from us, we'll be driven to certain reasonable conclusions. A charge will be prepared against you for having received bribes, and I may say we have witnesses.
How could you? Witnesses to what?
Witnesses sufficient to uphold a charge of bribery. And if you might escape that, sir, I couldn't answer for your future.
Do you have more to say, Senator?
I think I know what a man values in the world. Comfort, a good reputation, some decent prosperity. Do you want these things?
Yes.
Then don't choose this morning of your life to scatter them away. Take a simple step. Accept the opinions of other men.
Senator, the Greeks had a view of hell. Not a hot place, they said, but cold, very cold. A place for forgotten souls to wander. The man who betrays his trust here goes, I hope, to that special hell.
Sir, I only want to go on record. Where's Grimes? Where's Senator Grimes?
Henderson went out to find him.
Mr. Chief Justice, I move that the Senate now proceed to vote on the articles according to the order the Senate adopted.
Mr. Chief Justice, before this motion is made, I should like to make a motion that the voting be postponed for half hour. I would like to explain my reasons for making this motion. I saw Senator Grimes last evening. He assured me he would be here this morning. I know it's his intention to come down...
Will the honorable member permit me to interrupt? Mr. Grimes is here. He will enter the chamber in a moment.
I withdraw my motion. Senate now proceed to vote upon the articles according to the order of the Senate just adopted.
In favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Senators, in conformity with the order of the court, the chair will now proceed to take the vote on the 11th article. Call the roll.
Mr. Anthony?
Mr. Senator Anthony, how say you? Is respondent Andrew Johnson, President of the United States, guilty or not guilty of a high misdemeanor as charged in the 11th article?
Guilty.
Mr. Baird? Mr. Senator Baird, how say you? Is the respondent Andrew Johnson, President of the United States, guilty or not guilty of a high misdemeanor as charged in the 11th article?
Not guilty.
Slow as the bills of the gods.
What? I thought some votes might change last minute. They haven't. He's got no way out.
Mr. Grimes?
Grimes.
Mr. Senator Grimes, how say you? Is the respondent Andrew Johnson, President of the United States, guilty or not guilty of a high misdemeanor as charged in the 11th article? Senator Grimes, sir, if you'd prefer not to rise.
Not guilty.
Harlan, how say you? Respondent Andrew Johnson, President of the United States, guilty or not guilty of a high misdemeanor as charged in the 11th article?
Guilty.
Henderson?
Not guilty.
Ramsey?
Guilty.
Ross? Mr. Senator Ross, how say you? Is the respondent Andrew Johnson, President of the United States, guilty or not guilty of a high misdemeanor as charged in the 11th article?
I look down into my open grave.
Not guilty.
What'd he say?
Louder. Louder!
Not guilty.
May 16, 1868, seven Republican senators stood against party and majority to acquit President Andrew Johnson from impeachment. Fessenden of Maine, Fowler of Tennessee, Van Winkle of West Virginia, Trumbull of Illinois, Henderson of Missouri, Grimes of Iowa, Ross of Kansas. None of them was elected to the Senate again. It was years later that their position was vindicated when the Tenure of Office Act was declared unconstitutional by the United States Supreme Court. Ross's vote ended his political career. When he returned to Kansas in 1871, he and his family suffered public abuse, physical attack, and poverty.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.